Anthropology of Law is the today's course title, and it fits the course reference number 0060, Discipline Law Science, version 04, module 1, reference number 0060-0104. The course is divided into two parts. The first part is deal with theoretical aspect matters, theoretical underpinnings, conceptual difficulties of definition, of defining the notion of anthropology. And the second part will be consecrated, will be reserved, or is planned for some case studies. What is to be understood by the notions such as anthropology of law? To talk about anthropology is to aim at a unified knowledge of man. But is there any such thing as a unified knowledge of man? Man is said to be multidimensional, and we all know that science even is not the less multifaculty. That means multidisciplinary. And within one faculty, as a single corpus of science such as philosophy or law, there are more than one trend, that is, more than one stance or position, tradition, doctrine, or conception. So the main problem to be faced with, to be asked, and to solve where this possible is there any such thing that can be called a unified view of man? If there is none, then the immediate consequence is the following. The immediate consequence will be that there is no such thing that can be called a science of man. But this is disastrous for us, not just because we have no answer for our dearest scientific enterprises. The knowledge of ourselves and of what we are doing and or supposed to be for ourselves, for our own need, mainly well-being, happiness, but also scientifically, we appear to be really ignorant of what as scientists we are doing. The first type of disaster may not count as really without solution, because if science does not solve the problem of our well-being and happiness, since we are forced naturally forced to search for that happiness, as Immanuel Kant said, we may be constrained to pursue it by other means. What about the second type of disaster? Just like we are under strong compulsion to naturally search for our happiness, we are also pushed by a natural instinct and curiosity to know ourselves out of the manifold things that surround us, which are not the less matter of knowledge, curiosity. What makes this second type of disaster more crushing is that we have no other way than investigating into the matter of the world, no other way than inquiring about the world and about our own selves. And where lies our benefit in doing so is that our approach to man is an ongoing and a long-enduring process, and maybe never-ending. The knowledge of man and may be none of the human affairs. Knowledge of man and maybe none of the human affairs can have absolute validity. It can only be relative. So there is a science of man, but this science is not, it's just of a relative knowledge. Object, origin, and nature of anthropology. The object of anthropology. Anthropology is etymologically is the study of the human being. Origin of anthropology. How did anthropology start? Where did it start from? Before investigating into the texture of his own nature, man has opened his unto the world he inhabits, his eyes. And to the world he inhabits, the world of things surrounding him, seeing that he is quite different from it, but entirely dependent on it. One thing is sure, the pre-Socratic philosophers did not start investigating into their own nature as men. Rather, they have approached the physical universe. In this, they are essentially men of physics, searching principle, searching anarche, that means principle in Greek, that can help them explain nature. It is usually said that Socrates has drawn the attention of his contemporaries from speculation about nature to the inner world of their own nature, enjoining them to know themselves as a duty to be performed towards their humanhood in order to excel in humanity. His preoccupations are essentially ethical. But the predicament of man to turn his inward eyes toward an inwardness is far from being a Socratic predicament. The predicament of man to turn his inward eyes toward his inwardness is far from being a Socratic predicament. For it has existed about 3,500 years ago before Socrates, since the Anu Temple, ANU, Temple of Black Egyptian Thought. In Black Egypt, we have that people who are called Anu, who are the builders of the temple, the first temples there in the Valley of the Nile. The Nile Valley. This is well known today, but maybe not quite wholly among scholars who, for the most part and most of the time, tries to deny it or doubt about it. The nature of anthropology. After a classical period and following the pre-Socratic is the 19th century and the 20th century scientific turn, which gave priority to a purely experimental scientific anthropology. Thus, it's to the physical anthropology. This is closely related to the quest of the origin of man, to the cultural anthropology called ethnology. However, the other forms of anthropological studies, most fundamental in many aspects, cannot be neglected. Let us turn to the other forms of anthropology. We have religious anthropology, for example, which talk of man and how it's linked with question of the transcendental, of the transcendent being, or that which, though not transcendent to man, supersedes his force of strength, understanding thereby that there is a force in this and that and or other view of man, religiously approach, on which man existent totally or relatively but basically depends on. This force can be the gods, the spirits, more or less diffused in nature, or and an absolute transpersonal, and finally, why not the personal God of Judaism, or this personal God in three persons as conceived by the Christians. Their discourse is not without edifying impact. Religious anthropology's discourse is edifying enough, upbuilding enough. It's one of the basis of education. The language used by the religions to teach man how to conduct himself is of symbolic nature, mostly mythical, myths or other narratives signifying to man his condition, fulfill both a theoretical and practical function. Theoretical in that it explains the condition of man, and practical in that it provides man with practical guidelines by justifying his myth. Religious anthropology has the advantage of providing an evocative language whereby the condition of man can be understood, a language which is direct and speaks to the intelligence of man via his heart. We have examples from the Gospel, the Good Samaritan. His major drawback, it is usually said, is that he cannot justify its teachings. Religious anthropologists usually say, lacking the means necessary for justifying or for his engaging in a justification process of what is teaching. And it cannot justify a teaching which lies on a mere spiritual experience, most of time millenarian. But this conception of religious anthropology is somehow parsimonial. Parsimonious. It's partial. It's not whole. It's not correct enough because of the existence and truly enlivened experience of faith. Concrete experience of faith. Even nowadays, when you talk about spiritual revival, Christian revival, which is true. So there is a true experience of faith and of a true and direct link of man to God and the Holy Ghost, which has prevailed since the dawn of Christianity, for example, and which today has a widespread testimony, the spiritual revival of the 70s, that means 1970s, down to our 21st century, or the 70s, or the Pentecostal era, down to our 21st century, today, which is usually called by French people Renouveau Charismatique, beside Charismatic Revival. Beside, it is said in the Bible, faith is the assurance of things not perceived or observed. So the question of faith or religion is a unique experience not to be approached through the veil of our physical senses, not even through our so-called intuition commonly held to be our higher faculty of knowledge. Faith is thus another kind of experience, not in any case to be approached scientifically. The experience of faith is an enigma, so to say. The religious language has been progressively supplied by a language which pretends to be grounded rationally, fondé en raison, as French people say. And this happened in the turn of the 5th century before Jesus Christ. Here we have another instance of the antecedence of the inner world quest of man by man himself before the Greek era, which the experiences of the first Christian communities and around Palestina and the surrounding, and just to recall some of the sources of Christian religion will show us this antecedents. The second type of anthropology that can be enlisted is the philosophical one. The essential of the philosophical reflections evolves around man, his life and works, so to say. To think of the human condition, philosophy uses the medium of rationality, a rational language of a conceptual and argumentative nature, as can be seen through Socrates' philosophical language concerning man is far from being merely theoretical. Rather, it is practical on its basis and in its purports, consequences. Philosophy, known to be the quest of wisdom, seeks to know how man is to conduct himself intelligently according to his nature, as the Stoic school will have it laid down. The famous "Know Thyself," readopted by Socrates, which is originally the basic cult predicament of the Apollo sect of the Temple of Delphi, is an exhortation to lucidity, if not awakening, and the rectitude of conduct. For modern philosophers, such as Descartes, Rousseau, Sartre, man has nothing else to do if not to define himself with no other help than his own intelligence and will. Man is autonomous, Kant said, and morality resides in the law given to oneself. Humanity does not need any transcending principle or being, outer or inner, but man is perfectible. Where lies the standards of his perfectibility may be a question to the modern philosopher. Well, anyway, this is what philosophical anthropology deal with. Let's turn to the scientific anthropology, beside the religious and the philosophical approach. Man, though a subject, a person, is also an object of scientific investigation. The scientific language is or pretend to be objective exclusively. It aims at establishing knowledge data on man, which have no other characteristic than their being based on the observation of human behavior, in the other of their constitution. The different sciences which have this vocation are sociology, psychology, ethnology. These sciences came to existence only at the end of the 19th century. As constituted of one main branch, philosophy, this discipline of study of men willing to replace their mother discipline to encounter some major epistemological difficulties which strongly limit their strictly scientific pretensions. The main difficulties are man is a free being. How is it his conduct to be accounted for without debasing him? How is man's conduct to be accounted for without debasing man, without betraying the specificity of his nature? Is it not the case that a free behavior is that which on an a priori ground predictable? It's a question to be asked, epistemological problem, to be asked the scientific, mind of science questioning on investigation on man. The second problem is man is in becoming. Man's always changes. Man, like every minute, man is another being. Well, there may be a substrate or that which underlines the whole being and sustains the whole being, as the old philosophers say, the substratum. How then is an objective discourse on man possible? Some experts go as far as holding a universal discourse impossible on the ground of a fallacious gender distinguo, that between male and female, that distinction between man and man, man and woman, they go as far as holding a universal discourse on man impossible. According to them, there can be no female psychology because human behavior is more cultural than natural, which sounds a nonsense, at least in our view. While we might agree on a difference between male and female behavior on many points, to hold a female behavior something fundamentally merely cultural is to deny the female her being a free being that is also a rational being. For example, for if man designating both the male and the female gender is free and rational, how can the female alone be reduced to a mere cultural being? Again, recalling the first point, man is a free being. If man's behavior is taken to be unpredictable, it is on the basis of his being naturally free. And in no case, because his unpredictability, his being free, is due to a cultural program implanted or fostered in him. Indeed, there are some cultural aspects of the female, but this is true of the male too. Finally, none of these aspects of man is an obstacle to a universal discourse. For at least we have freedom, will, reason, conscience as predicates, as attribute for man, both male and female. The third problem raised epistemologically in the field of scientific investigation on man is the uniqueness of the individual. Here too, the four underlying type of argument hold, for the uniqueness of the individual does not prevent from the scientific investigation on certain quantitative or quantifiable or observable data. The uniqueness of the individual does not prevent from the scientific investigation. But one should avoid the scientist fallacies, of which the two following: only that which is quantifiable is universal and universalizable. This is what we call scientist fallacies. The second is nothing unique can be an object of scientific investigation. The thing that is unique, that cannot be observed repetitively, that cannot repeat itself, has occurred at least more than once, cannot be an object of scientific investigation. That the psychologist might fall in the investigation on his own woman. Psychologist can start, studying his own wife. He can make many mistakes, or himself, pretending he knows himself very well, but nothing can be said as scientific on that point. That the psychologist might fail in the investigation on his own woman does not prevent another psychologist from investigating on his colleague's woman. If I fail, I'm a psychologist, and I fail studying my own wife, there may be another psychologist, or one of my colleagues may do it, may succeed in doing it. Now, can this failure be attributed to psychology as a science? The identity between the object and the subject of knowledge, which is the fifth point, and which is closer to the previous one. The object or the subject investigating on himself is at the same time the object of investigation. So how can the subject investigate in his own nature without deforming, without changing his own nature, without, well, laying down some positive solution, some positive aspect of his nature, forgetting about the negative ones? How is objectivity to be found in that study, in that approach of man? So the question is, how, or is there any total or absolute objectivity to expect from a man, scientist, or whatever, engage in a speech about himself, scientific discourse about himself? The problem here is that the scientist is a man of his period, imbued with the ideologies of his period, a way or other. For example, sociologists or historian, East or West, want to investigate on the causes of the Second World War and or the First, may be biased in his approach. But there, here, seem to lie under fallacy of scientism. The criterion of scientific knowledge, objectivity, among other criteria, though a strong criterion, does not call for any absoluteness. In other words, that we need to be objective in our scientific investigation does not yet mean we can be absolutely objective, nor does it mean we should satisfy ourselves with a slack criterion, a loose objectivity. Therefore, in matters of human science, the question is that of an ongoing progress toward a better account, because perfect knowledge of man is a dream, at least. The sixth question. Human science failed to give a unified account of man. This is a point alluded to in the introduction, invalidating the concept of scientific anthropology. The same conduct, our behavior, is subject to as many interpretations as the scientific standpoint from which it is observed, whether sociological, psychological, or cultural. You were greedy. The psychoanalyst is greedy. Who is greedy? He will relate it to his psychological evolution. If somebody is greedy, for example, the psychoanalyst will relate that greediness to his psychological evolution. For example, you may have stagnated on the anal stage. That's a way of explaining greediness. Or you may be psychically constipated and recourse to food. The sociologist will explain it on the basis of your social belongings. Now, these people that are naturally greedy compared to ours. And the ethnologist will call for the symbolic schemes of behavior and will eventually take interest in your or that greedy man's religious belief. Religious belief can push a man to be greedy or vice versa. Or at least the contrary, anyway. Partial conclusion of what has been laid down. There are questions that can be solved by science. These are questions of the how type concerning the occurrence of phenomena. However, certain questions of methodological realm condemn her to silence. These are the questions we have surveyed. We have enlisted very now, which are the trappings, the difficulties of a scientific approach to man, or of man. Beside this type of questions, methodological questions, there are those pertaining to the significance, to the giving of sense of things, on which science remains radically incompetent. Like Auguste Comte and the scientists of scientism just cannot pretend having the last word to say in the field of science. Beside the scientific anthropology, we have anthropology of law. Just like the other forms of anthropology, law counts as a fundamental dimension of the human being in his intercourse with other human beings. If anthropology is a scientific discourse on man, then anthropology of law is that discourse in its application to the field of man's normative, specifically legal intercourse with other men and his society as a whole. Law as religion is one of the oldest forms of regulative media among men. Its birth can scarcely be traced precisely, but we can venture saying it started with the first human families and later societies of families in their mutual intercourse or relations as with nature, environment, and so on and so forth. Law belongs to what anthropologists call culture. And culture means what man constructs, what man builds on the basis of the natural data, under whose influence someone lives. What man transforms in nature becomes a cultural thing, cultural item, a cultural data. The elaboration and the improvement of law are closely related to the operation of the complexification of language. language become more and more complex. To create, observe, or to contest the rules of law, it is necessary to be able to communicate on their subject and thanks to them. The reason why some experts are engaged in the search of the origin of human language, it is, however, important to know that the emergence of law did not occur with the birth of language, but only its importance as an instrument of social regulation depends, or rather, lead to the improvement of or elaboration and betterment of the law structure, legal societies, and legal association. The question, since we are dealing with anthropology of law, is why such science? Is there not sufficient to have religious anthropology, which in some way may be helpful to us, or more helpful than philosophical anthropology, or psychological or scientific anthropology, or let's say cultural anthropology? Oh, is it not sufficient to have a cultural anthropology? Why and for what purpose an anthropology of law? This is a question that may be asked. We can ask that question. At least nothing prevents a mind of science to ask that question. Law has its many histories. From the Western world, it has begotten its own system of representation. As for the Ten Commandments, law has a long history, coming from far, from an entity superior, from whom it derived all its might. This is true for even for Western societies. The absence of God provokes an increase in the dependence of on state, endowing the state with a majestic title. Absence of God lead to overpowering society or the state as a legal institution, modern or even antique. I don't know, we'll see. Differences are denied in the name of justice and equality. Unity tends to be confined or conflated with uniformity. Differences, should be said, are provided or do exist merely because of relations of justice, relation of equality that lies at the basis of this legal structure of society. Unity tends to be conflated with uniformity. This is what the consequences of one of the consequences of law or legal institution. Some mythologies attest this fact. Myth related to the Enlightenment, such as the eschatology of a society without classes. These are myths. The ideal of a similitude of all the members of the social bodies, the modern and democratic rule of an arithmetic majority, the absolute compliance or obedience of the minority, no matter its importance, and in some cases, the recourse to a fictional consensus that reality denies, in fact. As soon as he's elected, a new president, for example, a chief or a leader of a political faction during the campaign becomes the totem of all the French citizens or people, for example, or all of all the Russian people, all the Togolese people, for example. Such a process, if uncontrolled, can easily lead to a totalitarian state, mythologizing of one person who becomes a president. You know, it's a deification of that person. The cult of the personality, as like is very current in third world country, Africa especially, or Togo, for example. It also inspires the less extreme experiences, such as the providential state. That mythologizing or deification of the state structure or state's representative, president, for example, can lead to an extreme situation such as the providential state. The state becomes the origin and source of all that pertain to our well-being or happiness, and we await everything from the state. For what purpose, then, is an anthropology of law indispensable, urgent? It is just a catalogue of recipe, a formula for incompetent lawyers. Is that only? Is it just good for artistic entertainment, anthropology of law, or creative people, lovers of exotism? For what sake an anthropology of law? First of all, and for example, through an anthropology of law, the Western world can find, for Western world, for example, can find models of legal institution observed elsewhere and in other periods of time within its own society. This fact proves that there exists more than one logical patterns governing the edification of her legal institutions, the functioning of individuals and whole society. This pattern coexists side by side. They are simultaneous. Such facts may undermine the idea of evolution, indeed. Evolutionist theories are accustomed to thinking that primitives are dominated by a pre-logical thought. As well, some lawyers talk of a pre-legal type of social organization. Social organization deprived of any legal basis, characterized by what they call analogical reasoning, intuition, an irrational mixture of categories, belief in magic, etc. Prelogical or illogical way of reasoning. One can wonder what it can be. While civilized people, they say, or societies have discovered logical thought, this is a pure lie. Against this opinion, the authority of a Western man, a Western great philosopher, John Locke, for example, can be referred to. John Locke, criticizing logicians, asserts the following: if syllogism should be considered the only true instrument of reason and the sole means to acquiring knowledge, It may follow that before Aristotle, nobody knew anything in the world, or that none has been able to acquire knowledge by reason, and that since the invention of syllogism, there is one man out of 10,000 who is granted this advantage. Well, if Aristotle is said to be the one who invented syllogism, then we may say before him there had been no knowledge, and before him there had been no person endowed with capacity of knowing anything at all. But God, John Locke further asserts, God has not been so sparing towards man as to create them barely two-legged, that means with 2 feet, 2 legs, and let it for Aristotle to make them rational creatures. God has been loving kind to man. He has given them a spirit capable of reasoning without their being in need of learning forms of syllogism. It is not, I say, Locke said, by rule of syllogism that the spirit of man learned to reason. He has a natural faculty to perceive the convenience or the inconvenience of ideas, the appropriateness or the inappropriateness of ideas, and he can put them into a good order without all these embarrassing repetitions, that mean the syllogistic forms of syllogism. I'm sure, says John Locke, that I have been able to speak the truth without diminishing Aristotle, that these two forms, modes and figure of syllogism or of argumentation, are not the only nor the best means to think rationally, to lead to the knowledge of the true those who desire to find it, and who wish to make a better usage the cool of their reason so as to reach knowledge. So, briefly put, syllogism or logical thinking, we wonder what it is without involving all other forms of thinking of man. But Locke say, if we hold this, then that means before Aristotle or before the modern logician, no one has been able to think at all. Before the Western, the growth, the rise of the Western civilization, none of the previous society or civilization have been able to do anything at all. Locke's criticism seems judicious. Rationality and along with it conceptualization are faculties well shared among human beings, at least men of greater civilization than the Western have displayed greater skills of rationality and thoughtfulness before the Greek and the Romans, before the French and Germans, etc., have opened their mind and eyes in matters of rational thinking, of science and technologies, etc. Indeed, the two forms of thought, the primitive and the civilized, coexist in every individual as well as in any society. The Eskimo, for example, will be extremely logical in hunting the fox and the caribou, and that will not prevent him to believe that his shamans travel to the moon and to the bottom of oceans. Likewise, the enterprise leader, the businessman, can simultaneously recourse to the most sophisticated prediction models on the level of economy and to occult sciences to engage his personnel, to employ his personnel, let alone the extraordinary development of these sciences in France nowadays, or all over the world. An anthropology of love finds its first utility in its descriptiveness or comprehensiveness, for it helps us better understand our own society in terms of primitive or pre-legal and legal and logical thought. We find that they coexist in our own society, in any society. The anthropology of law will help us find this. To have seen certain models elsewhere of legal structure, legal organization, that can help us to have seen these models, other models elsewhere, help us in better recognize them in our own societies. The second utility of an anthropology of law lies in its prospective nature. Differences between diverse cultural traditions become better highlighted, become clear. Of the province of right and law, a Chinese, a European, and an Iranian have quite different views. So these differences will come to light through anthropology of law. Of this fact, many businessmen begin to have a good appreciation, and now they very often rely on anthropologists. Their view is the following. Since we start being aware of the dreadful crisis that our own legal models are facing with, the fact that other societies have been able to live according to principles sometimes very far, very different from ours, but have been builders of great civilization and cultures, is rather encouraging. So said businessman today. For anthropological knowledge, especially anthropology of law, some of the mechanisms that commonly appeal to contrary to us are rather so appalling. Those people, those societies who have no modern mean technology, modern structure of legal structure. They commonly appeal to contrary to us. These people are rather so appalling as to really correspond to our present needs, or some their mechanism correspond to our present needs. Mediation, problem solving through mediation, social mediation, family mediation, legal or juridical pluralism, consensus reaching, decentralization, etc. These elements could contribute to the elaboration of a new type of democracy, for example, less primary, if not primitive, than the one based on the principle of an arithmetic majority. There is, however, one difficulty not to be emphasized. The condition of reception and implantation of experiences of other cultures and civilizations. Transplantations of Western juridical or legal organs in other societies always end up in serious fiasco. For example, in Africa, the question is to know if we need to transplant just to take social organization, legal mechanism of the Western hemisphere, and just put it down there, and try to live by. Will we advance in it or not? This is a question. Examples are their inefficiency, the lack of operationality of this mechanism in Black Africa. There are more and more brutal rejection in Muslim countries, for example. These are some examples. I mean, they are mere fact, concrete fact that should normally bring us question ourselves. People engage in governmental studies and so on and so forth, politicians and all, lawyers and so on and so forth. This fact should prompt in us cautiousness. We should be cautious. The point here is that Western society are accustomed to the leading omnipresence of state, the leading omnipresence of state and its modes of intervention. The anthropologist can suggest to manage and rearrange the institutional realm, but not to eradicate it, suppress it. While the Western society are accustomed to the leading omnipresence of the state and other society not, this is a fact, a plain truth, or just a plain fact, concrete fact for an anthropologist. So he can suggest to political agent, political to leaders, to governmental students, or those who are in power to manage and rearrange the institutional realm. But it cannot suppress it. Even in society where the state is less present, order cannot be suppressed, eradicated. The case for legal pluralism: is cultural pluralism an obstacle to the unity of humanity? This is an important question. Today, we live in a multicultural world today. We talk about globalization and people come from far in the Western hemisphere with their own culture, but they are constrained, they are forced to live together with other people. They are obliged to live by their own cultural rules or principles. Problems of excision. Problem of the wearing of a chador or the scarf. Problem of cultist way of killing animals are there in our society, and they provoke shock of all kinds in people who do not share the same culture with their neighbors. And we are forced to live together with all these kind of rules. How can we manage? Can I at the same time affirm the equivalence? Is it possible to affirm the equivalence of all values and will and one desire to combat injustice? If all values are equivalent, how and I desire combat injustice, struggle against injustice? What is to be taken as injustice? This is one of the important questions that legal pluralism for society nowadays causes. This question that some experts usually ask, and this has been a dissertation subject for bachelor students in 1990, for example, in France. But the question, at least one of them, The first, that means, is cultural pluralism, an obstacle to the unity of humanity? This first question seems rather illogical to us, for one may reply with other questions. Do we need cultural pluralism? That is a normative, precisely a normative recognition of all cultures to consider and recognize humanity as designating a basically, originally unified spaces. It's cultural pluralism an obstacle to the unity of humanity? And our reply is this question. Is cultural pluralism necessary? And cultural pluralism, precisely as a normative recognition of all cultures, do we need that to consider and recognize humanity as designating or as meaning a basically or originally unified spaces? Don't we need a certain basic condition, rather, a certain humanity, that it's a certain type, basis, essentials or fundamental, certain standards of values universally shared by all? To speak of cultural pluralism, what comes first? I mean, before talking about cultural pluralism, we should first of at first sight recognize unity or equivalence, let's not say equivalence, you know, resemblance of some values among share or among different cultures, different people, different nations. And is that cultural pluralism? We are not yet dealing with cultural pluralism as a normative recognition of our cultures. We just observe what people is at this place, what people at that place, what people in my home, what people in my neighbor's homeland do. Because normative recognition of our culture implies some other institutional procedures. This is what, I mean, the core of my question. And the question is misleading. Is cultural pluralism an obstacle to the unity of humanity? Well, so we need a certain basic condition, certain humanity. From the standpoint of observation, mere observation to talk about cultural or to recognize the resemblance, identity, similarity of values. Humanity comes first, not cultural pluralism. Or in other words, in humanity, not the condition of possibility of cultural pluralism. What is called by humanity here, maybe it is not what I think. The biological and the moral, and what is called by cultural pluralism here, if it is the biological and the moral that are designated or meant by humanity, then the reply is pertinent. Well, I mean, if it's the biological and the moral, which we call humanity, and if what we call cultural pluralism is the biological and the moral that, then our reply is pertinent. Thus, we may find an identity of element defining both humanity and cultural pluralism. And that means we do not need any structural institutional procedures or protocol to define or to recognize the unity of our humanity, the unity of human beings in all spheres existing, or hemisphere existing. Likewise, if it is that which immediately derives, so to say, from universal, the human, biological and moral, which also mean the cultural, for morality of whatsoever universal character is necessarily rooted in a given cultural soil. If it is that, if it is humanity, which immediately derives from the universal, the cultural pluralism, which immediately derived from the universal, from the human, biological and moral, which also mean cultural. Then there is no opposition and there is no clash between cultural pluralism and humanity as such. Some people will say we are too abstract reasoning this way, but one should recognize that the question itself is of an abstract character, posed to be solved or to resolve concrete problem. If so, then we have no other way to tackle it than by questioning the abstract notions. First point to make here is the following: all axiological or all value strata, all axiological or all value equivalence implies difference of values. To talk about equivalence of value implies difference of value and rules out universality. To talk about equivalence of value implies difference of value, and this difference of value prevents us from talking about universality. Or the reverse, universality with universality, or universality, axiological universality, the sharing of the same values by all members of the human species exclude all thesis or the validity of all axiological equivalence or difference. The second point follows. If we want to speak of axiological equivalence in a multicultural context with a necessary appeal to an axiological universal complex and concrete, we should either, first of all, specify the locus, the lieu of the injustice that can be committed, or second, we should either note that there is no place at all for any injustice in the context of a sound axiological equivalence. If we want to speak of axiological equivalence in a multicultural context with a necessary appeal to an axiological universal concrete universal, first thing is to specify the lieu, the moment of the injustice that can be committed. We should determine what kind of injustice people can commit. If we want to talk about axiological equivalence, and within the multicultural context, because we cannot jump over people and tell them, no, they are committing injustice. We have to show that their value, rather show that their value has nothing unjust. what they are committing is not unjust. Just like ours is not unjust, our own value. Or second, we should agree that there is no place at all for any injustice in the context of a sound axiological equivalence. The first is to determine the injustice that people, or at least a certain kind of actions, and stamp, qualify them as injustice or unjust act. The second is, well, we should agree just bodily that there is no place at all for any injustice in that context. Since axiological equivalence means the acceptance of all values as of equal worth or weight. For example, killing by self-justice as equal to absolute forgiveness. Is there any logic in him killing by self-justice as an act equal to absolute forgiveness? In the first case, that is, when we are engaged in specifying the lure of the injustice, what kind of actions are unjust or just, we will face a situation like that of, first, a wrong application of the rule of law shared by all. Of the standard of justice, a wrong application of the standard of justice recognized by all. Situation of ignorance or negligence of certain facts or parameters by the magistrates. This is, for example, where we can talk about, or when we can talk about injustice. If we are in a multicultural milieu, and we hold that all values are equivalent, then we have no way to talk about, in any case we can talk about injustice, unless we determine precisely what we understand or when precisely is an injustice committed. And there are some patterns of actions I list as the only or possible action that can be termed or qualified unjust. First, it's a wrong application of the rule of law that is shared by all. Wrong application of the standard of justice recognized by all. Or a situation of ignorance or negligence of certain facts or parameters by the magistrate. Second, situation like that of partiality or favoritism. Third, situation like that of a judiciary mafia, especially in matters pertaining to drugs dealing, money laundering or recycling, highway corruption. Fourth, of sentences of justice stained by racism and the strong influences or sentiment or impulse of cultural imperialism. The third point can be stated as follows. It is simply to be noted that some values are far from being shared everywhere, which is understandable. But the question to be asked is this: what kind of values they are? Certainly they are not the universal one shared by all human cultures. Killing us is bad and is to be punished. There may be values such as killing for honor is good in certain circumstances. Killing to prevent other criminals is good. Not honoring one's promises is good in certain circumstances. For example, a promise to give back to give back a weapon to a crazy man, a mentally dangerous man, to which the weapon belongs. This is a Kantian example. So we see that the one who ventures reasoning that all values are equivalent is simply not in the right reason. First, because the value killing for honor is just not equivalent to killing simply. This is a precise determination, at least. Or there are some more refined ones, which are sheer... Well, okay. I repeat. First, because the value killing for honor is just not equivalent to killing simply, which is shared by some Ku Klux Klan members, for example, skinheads, and some more hooligans, some other hooligans. Maybe I'm mistaken, because there may be an honor in their clan or camp, let alone thieves under the pressures of being caught. They kill simply. But they never kill for honor. Honor should be defined according to social values and not because of any lack of value at all. Second, killing for honor. Associations do have the right to exist in society, but we should ask ourselves if an undemocratic and not liberal association deserve existing in a liberal society. If liberal, I should encourage them to live, if they should entertain them. Second, killing for honor is not shared by all members of the human species. Christians, for example, abhor value of this kind, and other cultures as well, like the ancient Egyptian, and Socrates propounded it too. Krishnamurti is in the rank, the Dalai Lama spread it around. Killing for honor is not shared by or members of our society. Other instances, economic values is robbing the poor, misgoverning, maladministrating public good, giving way to non-transparency and corruption on the state level, or multinational private enterprises and nations or people intercourse for the purpose of promoting economic growth or development, is that equivalent to good governance as such? It does not seem to be the case. So what sort of value are equivalent when talking about injustice precisely? When injustice is involved, we cannot talk about equivalence of values, though we recognize that those who give the sentence of justice or say from the UN Council of Security are not that pure, that just, that impartial, but they are prompted by impartiality because corrupted to their neck, or just simply by a sentiment of racism or mere pretension of superiority. The basic premise of the one who reasons asserting the equivalence of all values is just not true. This premise falls, and since an argument based on false premise can never be valid or just, therefore, the conclusion of the argument or reason is false too. The final touch to our line of argumentation is, which is not less important than the others, and rather, which should be duly considered, we are talking about values, is robbing to support one's familiar value, is the spoliation of other countries' goods for the purpose of promoting the well-being of one's own citizens of value. This is far from being the case. Like Immanuel Kant have it laid down, we can say that we are in a situation where the dignity of people of whole generations, which is a value in its own intrinsic worth, is exchanged with money and or power, which have less or no value but only a price. As such can be an exchange. Dignity can never be exchanged. Money can lend itself to such operation. And we are in such a situation that money, which has only no value in its own, which can be exchanged duly because it only has a price, since it is exchanged with something of a more worth, it is diminished of its own weight down to nothing. Dignity, however, can say, has no price. It is the value in itself. Or to conclude from our approach, first, that we do deny that cultural pluralism is a threat to the unity of humanity. We do deny that cultural pluralism is a threat to the unity of humanity. Second, that asserting the equivalence of all values is false. Third, that admitting of an equivalence of values, that means only of some values, only of some values, is picking some other type of values that can be given the qualification of secondary values, or complex of values within a single higher one, since, as we have seen, there are certain values that are shared by all the members of the human species. But within the scheme of one single value, say, the respect of human life, for example, the application of the rule of law or principle of justice can involve killing or death penalty or killing for honor. That means the notion of cultural pluralism should be investigated in and accurately understood. What is cultural pluralism then? The concept of cultural pluralism in its slightest sense, the concept refers to the coexistence of different juridical mechanisms that apply to identical situations. We're talking about juridical or legal mechanism and not values. Well, juridical, those mechanism should be decided, should be chosen upon due consideration of a certain scheme or configuration or pattern of values, but that are technical values, maybe. Or for to attain, to reach certain social aim, which may be values which are necessarily are values in themselves. But here, to give more precision to the concept of cultural pluralism, we decided to define it as the coexistence of different juridical mechanisms that apply to identical situations and have the same validity. We have, for example, the commercial, the trade contract, in which the trader sells its good according to rules less constraining than the rest of the citizens, for the sake of being more competitive, maybe, or because he pays higher taxes than them. You say the trader sells his good according to rules less constraining than the rest of the citizen, just for the sake of being more competitive, maybe, or because he pays higher taxes than them. In its stronger sense, cultural pluralism is inspired by the idea that the different social groups that form a nation-state experience the crossing over of multiple legal or juridical orders. The different social groups, associations that form a nation state experience the crossing over of multiple legal or juridical orders, the state system of law or state law, but also an informal system of law produced by other groups. Both systems, the formal and informal, able of coincidence or convergence. For example, a laboring immigrant is subjected to the regulations internal to the enterprise that employs him. He makes use of the state law pertaining to Social Security's regulation applicable to his condition and from which he gets diverse allocations. He distributes these allocations in his family according to criteria eventually customary or traditional, different from criteria enforced in French law, namely condition of the female. Consequently, it should be more appropriate to speak of pluralism of legal or juridical mechanism than of juridical pluralism. There lies the nuance. We should talk of pluralism of legal mechanism or juridical mechanism instead of juridical pluralism or legal pluralism, just simply. For the first concept implies the coexistence of the convergence of multiple orders of legal mechanism. The stronger sense of the concept can generate many conflicts. Cultural or traditional laws, say of excision, the reveling of minor children from parental authority exerted by some sects. Drug dealers' compact, which are all contrary to what is defined by the state law as public. Again, canon law, for example, still prohibits divorce, but state law decriminalized it since 1984 in France. The first prohibits abortion, the canon law prohibits abortion. The second depenalizes it since 1975. In the old law, church and state condemned money lending at rate or interest, but traders did practice it, etc. The stronger sense of legal pluralism, which is the coexistence within one nation state of multiple legal or juridical order may generate problem. This is what we mean. And the example just given show that there's indeed problem there. The universality of the rule of law. Sociology and anthropology of law teach us that the legal or juridical qualification of an act is variable within one in single society. For example, the prohibition of smoking in the metro proceeds from the rule of law, but somewhere else it is a rule or law of social convenience, respect, or politeness, or more accurately put, a principle of hygiene. Sociology and anthropology of law teach us also that the significance of legal prescriptions can vary according to societies. The previous example of homicide is an example of this fact. Homicide can be a sign of virility or weakness. Here we should pause for a remark. Whether we share the thesis of humanity springing from one genealogical tree root or not, cultural pluralism is a fact undeniable. Likewise, since no society can survive in time unless it has set up public rules to regulate its own functioning, it is to be admitted that legal pluralism is not a historical truth to be confirmed and allowed by a legal institution of whatever kind. Legal pluralism is in itself a legal institutional fact to be regulated only within and by one mainstream legal institution. It's there. It is there. So legal pluralism is there just as humanity is there. Legal pluralism should be regulated, and there will follow the improvement of humanity. Thus, there is a certain fallacy from the Western societies nowadays to propound the principle of cultural pluralism as a fact to be admitted on the basis of Western tradition of law, since cultural pluralism is there. Since the origin or the multiplication or the multiplication of human members of humanity, since the multiplication of families, societies, cultural pluralism is there. So it is a fallacy from the Western societies to propound principles of cultural pluralism as a fact to be admitted on the basis, merely on the basis of Western tradition of law. Modernity as an invention coming from Western legal tradition on the one hand, and on the other hand, it is a tangible sign of Western cultural and legal imperialism and incoherence as well to deny that very legal pluralism that should ensue from the basic cultural pluralism of humanity, a cultural pluralism that is no obstacle to the basic universalism or universality that underlines the original axiological system of human society. Thus, it is useless to search for the universality of law immediately within its content. As said before, according to some experts, this universality should be inferred from the functionality, solely from the functional definition of law, which is the necessity of a regulatory system of society supported by a coercive mechanism and aiming at resolving conflict or litigation. To our opinion, the universality of law need not be derived from any definition at all. Foremost, it is a question of observance. And here we follow Aristotle, Montesquieu, Rousseau, Hegel, and the nowadays political culture movement like that of to whom belong Almond and Werber, for example. And the movement is called political culture. Right. And the functionalist thesis spread as follows. Through the diverse experience of law made by human society or some groups, law is what seems indispensable to these society and groups for their social cohesion and reproduction. Thus, legal pluralism has the characteristic not of an infralegal phenomenon, but rather those corresponding to the legal systems proper to subgroups within mainstream society. There we end up we end, we conclude the theoretical part of this course. Tomorrow, we'll be dealing with cases study and cases such as excision and the problems caused by the wearing of the Islamic scarf. Thank you very much.